В нашем проекте «Реальные люди» сегодня мы поговорим о том, что из себя представляет Офис Верховного комиссара ОБСЕ по делам национальных меньшинств, чем он отличается от того, что делают в Совете Европы, и как правильно взаимодействовать с ним. Различные неправительственные организации в России в последнее время часто говорят о дискриминации по этническому и языковому принципу. Поэтому мы решили узнать, входят ли такие кейсы в сферу ответственности ОБСЕ. У нас в гостях по онлайн-связи Верховный комиссар ОБСЕ по делам национальностей Ламберто Заньер. Good morning, Mr. Zanier. We warmly welcome you in our program.
Good morning. I'm glad to join you this day.
Could you explain the differences between the Council of Europe's divisions, which deal with the national minority issues, and your office?
The Council of Europe bases its activity on a framework convention on national minorities. So let's say the basis of the engagement of the Council of Europe is legal in terms of nature and is based on the engagement of the states through the ratification of the convention to a certain level of treatment of the minorities. So this is about minority protection, it's about human rights, and it's about the implementation of mechanisms that have been set up by the Council of Europe to follow up on all this. My mandate is very different. My mandate is not a minority protection mandate, it's a conflict prevention mandate. The engagements that I'm looking at are engagements of the participating states of the OSCE to invest in peaceful relations among them, and it is in this context that I look at the relationships between governments and minorities, and governments which are not necessarily only the governments of the countries where the minorities reside, but it's also sometimes the governments of the so-called king states, which are the states of reference to ethnic minority groups, and look at the complex of this relationship and try to assess issues that may create instability or may create crisis in this kind of relationships. Of course, I work very closely with the Council of Europe. How can I say, it's very adjacent, the work that I do, to that of the Council of Europe, and we have a constant interchange and a constant cooperation.
In which cases do you interfere situations? What should happen in a member state to bring you to interfere a situation? What about language rights protection strikes? Can they be a reason for your interference?
Yes, of course, of course. I wouldn't call it interference. It's simply intervening and engaging with governments. Conflict prevention is based on early warning. So I'm analyzing the situation across the membership of the OSCE, and I have a mandate that allows me to intervene, to ask questions to countries, to visit the countries, and to report back to the countries themselves, who are the ones who gave me a mandate. And it is in this context that I work also with the Council of Europe. And one of the differences between us and the Council of Europe is that the Council of Europe makes reports that are discussed with the countries themselves and then publishes them. So you have a very, how can I say, transparent engagement of the Council of Europe. My way of operating is very different. It's based on what we call quiet diplomacy. So I look at issues like the ones you mentioned, language and education, in general, and the principles that inspire us, principles that have been codified by a number of high commissioners over the years. We have many sets of recommendations issued by high commissioners over the last 20 years. And these recommendations set out a complex web of recommendations and guidelines which, when they are respected, will guarantee that there is stability in relations. So these touch many aspects. Education, you mentioned, language, you mentioned. I can add the police. I can add access to justice. I can add the use of media and access to media. I can also add rules that we have developed, and we will be marking next week at an event in Italy, in Udine, the so-called Bolzano-Bolzan recommendations on the relations between countries in respect of national minorities. So there are certain things that the country where the minority resides is entitled to do, and there is a limit to how much neighboring countries can intervene in support what they perceive as their communities abroad, communities that from an ethnic perspective are close to those countries, but from a legal perspective are residing in the country, therefore the jurisdiction, the sovereignty is that of the country where they reside. That is a difficult and sensitive balance. And we intervene discreetly with all sides to try to advise them on best practices in addressing the issues that are controversial, and it can be any of the ones that I mentioned, and they try to promote a less conflictual relationship.
From time to time, you visit member states. I suppose you meet not only with the officials, but also with NGO activists. Do you have influence on making a list of those who are invited to the meeting with you? I mean, NGO activists.
Of course, I wouldn't call them NGO, I would call them more broadly civil society and more general representatives of the minorities. We do have a relationship with key representative of minority groups throughout the OSCE area. So when I travel, of course I meet with the governments, but I also meet with these representative of minority groups, and then in some cases with other members of the civil society, some NGOs, etc. But to me, I feel that I have a role of a bridge between the minorities and the governmental institutions, and then whatever source can help me analyze the problems and identify possible solutions, that is of course welcome. So when I visit a country, I always have a pretty busy schedule and a long list of interlocutors, and this is something that I set up myself with the assistance of my experts, who have they are in a way the masters of this, and they are the ones who control these networks. And every visit of mine is prepared by visits of my own experts, who go to the country at a more technical level, and in fact prepare the program of my visit to make sure that I don't hear only one side of the story, but that I have access to information and to perceptions also from everybody, because this will allow me also to take a more balanced approach in the recommendations that I put forward.
Do you have an opportunity to check the information provided by the authorities of a member state, of a government-organized, non-governmental organization?
Well, there are many ways for me to do this. I mentioned earlier the relationship with the Council of Europe, and the Council of Europe reports are already a good source of information for me on the situation in a certain country and in a certain area of interest. Secondly, as I say, I'm talking to as many interlocutors as I can. But then thirdly, one other element that I have is the work with the academic and research environment, because that is giving me another angle. There are people who spend their time working on these issues from a research and from an academic point of view, who have a huge amount of expertise on these, and some of these best experts are around a web of European universities. So I'm keeping also those channels open, and I'm trying to have access also to this kind of analysis, so that I have many sources of information that I can check on, and then try to avoid the risk of being somehow indoctrinated by just one of the sides. But I just make it as my key working method, that of having multiple sources as much as possible.
Is your office restricted by the authorities of a member state when it wants to take any steps? Have you ever faced these kind of obstacles?
Well, restriction is a big word, but certainly the first thing I would say is that we are living at a time where geopolitics is back. And when relations between the country become more polarized, between countries become more polarized, also issues revolving around minorities become more politicized. And this is making the space for me to engage a little bit less open, and I have to find ways to navigate in this space in a way that I don't I'm not perceived as the friend of one of the sides engaging or looking into what the other is doing. A second set of problems has to do with the interpretation of my mandate, a mandate that goes back to the early 90s. And at that time, when it was developed, it focused on events in the former Yugoslavia and the former Soviet Union, where borders appeared virtually overnight, borders that divided communities, that created minorities in a very short time frame. And that was, in a way, the basis for the development of this of the mandate of the Office of High Commissioner as a stabilizing tool in that context. Now we are seeing that societies are growing more diverse. Over the years, as I mentioned, the recommendations that the High Commission has developed, I think a particularly significant set of recommendations has been also drafted. And those are the Ljubljana recommendations on integration of diverse societies. Those are based on experiences that were developed working on the traditional minorities and looking at every aspect of social inclusion, the successful social inclusion of minority groups in a society, which is what makes a society stable and resilient to crisis and resilient to conflict. Now, if we look around, there are new kinds of minorities. Our societies are becoming diverse everywhere, in Western Europe, in Eastern Europe, in different ways. The impact of the massive migration phenomenon that we've seen on the society is creating populism and fueling nationalism in many cases. And we need to protect our societies from this. So we need to work to make sure that our societies are integrated everywhere. Now, every now and then, I see trends to, how can I say, interpret my mandate in a conservative manner and push back when I look into the stability of societies in their own merit. And this is something where I will keep doing, because I think that security is related to every aspect of balance of the society, and not only to depending on definitions that countries may or may not give to certain parts of the societies to somehow not acknowledge difficulties in integration.
Do you have any mechanisms to punish a member state for its discriminatory policy towards its national minorities?
The OSCE is built in a way that it is not the organization as such that applies mechanisms, but it's the countries themselves that assess behaviors of other countries and decide how to react to those. There are many examples of this. Even the fact that there are sanctions among countries of the OSCE over perceived violations, perceived or real violations of key principles of the OSCE, is an example of application of OSCE tools to violations of these commitments. Even though they are taken in a different environment and in a different setup, there is an OSCE logic to how that works. And it's not by chance that the OSCE is the organization that, in cases like the crisis in and around Ukraine, is engaging to SMM also in Donbas to try to monitor and provide some assistance to the hopefully resolution of that crisis. So in my case, this is the same. So if I find a problem, and whenever I find a problem, I report about it. I report about it to the ambassadors, to the permanent council. They will decide how to follow it up in the discussions among themselves. And they may request me to take further steps, to engage, to try to assist sides in resolving their differences over specific issues. So that's where I continue with my quiet diplomacy interventions to work on issues that can stretch from education to language to citizenship to participation in social life, etc., with the countries and try to make progress as instructed by the chairmanship and the countries and the member states.
When are you going to visit Russia next time? And will you visit Volga region?
The last visit of the High Commissioner to Russia is almost 10 years ago. So I am now planning to go to Moscow at the end of October. We're now negotiating, discussing the dates. There is, in principle, a willingness of the Russian authorities to meet with me. So my plan would be, for this time, to go to Moscow to re-establish those connections that were somehow lost over time. I would like to meet with representatives of minority communities when I'm in Moscow, and then we will take it from there, and then we will see whether there will be further opportunities for me to come back to Russia and to visit specific regions, and I will do this in close consultation with the Russian authorities.
Mr. Zanier, thank you very much indeed for joining us. У нас в гостях по скайпу был Верховный комиссар ОБСЕ по делам национальных меньшинств Ламберто Заньер. Смотрите нас на нашем сайте idelreal.org, а также на наших страницах в соцсетях. До новых встреч!